Not me getting owned by the Quetzalcoatl. That was just a demo.
Not yet, at least.
Oh, it's gonna happen sooner or later, but that's not me right now. There would be music playing if that was me fucking up. But in any case, 30th anniversary of Castlevania, joined by Pulahoko as always.
Yeah, hello.
And our good buddy Max.
What's up, guys?
So yeah, 30th anniversary of Castlevania was yesterday, I believe. And Konami really didn't do fucking much for it. They sent a...
I'm surprised.
They sent a tweet congratulating the series for its 30th anniversary after making something saying, like, also, happy birthday to the N64. Like, that came first. So, yeah, okay, great.
It's like getting your kid a birthday gift from a gas station.
You know what? It's actually...
It's kind of like you've got a brother that has a birthday kind of close to yours. So he gets all, like, the good presents and parties and shit first, and then it comes time for yours, and it's kind of like, eh.
Whatever. Yeah, it's like, oh, don't worry there, Jimmy. We also got you a keychain. It's, your name's only got kind of fucked up on it. Listen, your brother gets the Epcot keychain. You get the Magic Kingdom one. I know Epcot's way cooler, but your brother really likes Epcot, Jimmy.
And it just took us so long to find that one that, you know, we were in the area, and you kind of like Magic Kingdom too, right?
Yeah, are you saying you don't like the Magic Kingdom? Because if you don't like the Magic Kingdom, I will turn this car around right now. Dad, we're still in New York. We never left. It's winter. We summer vacation's in a couple. I will turn this car around.
Oh, man.
All right. So, let's fucking jump into this.
Oh boy, what, the Quetzalcoatl?
Yeah. So, I'm playing this on a PS4 controller because I bought that USB converter for some goddamn reason, and I'm getting something out of it, goddammit.
I mean, it's been a bit finagling with the PS3's crowdsourced drivers that still don't work.
Hmm. So, I'm noticing something. Or, more I'm noticing a lack of something.
I'm noticing, I don't know what you could be talking about.
I'm noticing a little lack of something right here. Let's, try that again.
There
it
is.
Do we have to do it the opposite way now?
Yeah.
Do I have to be the DJ now?
There we go.
Man, speaking of, advance apologies to anybody watching who was tuning in, hoping to see more of Dave playing Tetris.
So,
I mean, you still might later on, but it's kind of a special occasion tonight, so...
Yep.
I do plan on playing some more of that, because the later levels apparently get really hard.
Are you sure you want to put yourself through that?
No, it's fun. That's what I consider that fun.
It's fun turning old white people into hamburger.
Although, the fastest I've ever gotten rid of the dagger, and thank God. Also,
does
I'm hopping
over. Suck?
I'm always hopping over these motherfuckers. Gotcha.
I was one of those assholes that never ever used the extra weapons in Castlevania, or even like Mega Man half the time.
You don't really need it for some of the later ones, but you absolutely need it for this one. This game is, like, designed around all that.
That's fair.
Alright.
I mean, I play through, like, Bloodlines usually without doing anything because I'm boring.
Yeah, Bloodlines, I don't think you need it, mostly because the spear is so over-goddamn powered.
Yeah, not really.
Alright, so I'm gonna see if I can... I'm gonna try this one more time, see if I can get it. Yeah! So I like all the little, like, damage skips that you can do to, like... completely avoid doing the basement part of that level.
One phrase I haven't heard in a long time, takes damage to save time.
A friend of mine from PFGC used that phrase to some notoriety playing Mega Man 2 on a stream once in front of like dozens of people at Mega Man 2, and he fucking bit it on Airman's stage.
Oh
boy.
I think he was actually going for like a speedrun or something, but he just... He doesn't want to talk about that anymore.
We don't mention that. Dad, hey, what happened back years ago when you played Mega? I don't want to hear about that.
We don't talk about Airman in this household, in this Billy. House.
I don't even think he plays real video games anymore. Last I heard, he was asked even
Hearthstone. Oh my god, did he stop playing video games because of the Mega Man 2 thing?
No, not quite. I think he actually still plays fighting games too, but like, we kind of stopped playing games because like Hearthstone happened, and Heroes of the Storm, for some reason, he was playing that too. Which strikes me as weird, because I don't think Jay was a big fan of Blizzard before then.
I'm about to say Blizzard claims another victim.
I mean, I never really had anything for Blizzard until Overwatch, of course.
I mean, same.
And I tried Heroes of the Storm mostly because it's got the Lost Vikings in it. And
yeah, I mean, everything is great about Heroes of the Storm except for playing it.
Yeah.
I was WoW in Burning Crusade era.
I tried WoW. I tried it, you know, back when I first went into service, they gave you this coupon that got 50% off of the in-base store for anything. It was
wow.
Like unlimited. But it was like one thing or one trip.
Mm-hmm.
So I bought a laptop for 50% off.
Nice.
And I tried to load World of Warcraft onto it, and it ran, but it would overheat.
Yeah, so which is really weird because it's archaic as fuck. It's so dated. And it still is. Oh, nice skip.
Thanks. I'm upset that I got killed that first time. This one's a little tough. I'm gonna try it one time. If you just keep going straight, wait for it to hit, and then immediately hop up, you can apparently just walk almost right through it. I was off by a little bit.
Yeah, do you still play World of Warcraft for somebody that wants referrals or something?
Sort of. This is actually the second time I've done it, too. The first was my first summer vacation in college. Mm-hmm. I was working... I had gone from the dorms to my hometown in Valpo because I had a job nearby from my uncle. I was cleaning raccoon shit out of industrial freezers for $7.50 an hour. It was a grand old time. But a friend of mine wanted to get a recruit gift mount for somebody else. And to do that, you need to get somebody to play WoW and buy like a subscription. And so they did. And I played it and they were really enthusiastic about WoW. So I tried to get through it, but like it was the biggest grind ever. It was just a miserable, sterile experience. And I don't know why I managed to get up to like level 40 or whatever in the 3 months.
Let's say what generation was that in?
Oh Jesus, I think that was Wrath of the Lich King.
Okay, so I was before that. I played Burning Crusade when I played. Literally, my college roommate almost got kicked out of college because he got wrapped up into World of Warcraft.
Because he got sucked into it.
Yeah,
it's a hell of a drug. I mean, if you're into that kind of gameplay
experience.
For some
people, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not. I'm playing through it again only because there's a chance I might be able to get somebody to play WildStar for a while.
And you genuinely like WildStar.
I actually like WildStar. Like, I don't like MMOs in general, but WildStar does, like, just enough right that I'm interested. All right, because
this skip's gonna be a little tough.
Oh, boy.
Yes!
All right!
Oh, nice! Imp skip.
Yep, get the little flea man to help you out.
Like, WildStar was made by a lot of ex-Blizzard employees, and they basically said, like, let's take the base experience of WoW, but, like, cut all of the bullshit out and make the combat system fun. I mean, like, 90% of what you do in WildStar is just watch the floor for pepperoni and AoE things to, like, dodge stuff, but, like, it's pretty intense.
As we put it,
it's a lot more than just watching your cooldowns and pressing buttons at the right time. You move around, and it feels a lot more skill-based. It's more involved, and it's a lot quicker to level. Your quests are genuinely, like, entertaining and varied, as opposed to kill 10 things to get 10 items, but really you're killing, like, 22 or 24 because the drop rate is really low, and Blizzard hates you.
I'm really glad that FF14, when I started playing that, they really cut down on that bullshit.
I was about to mention, I never saw myself getting into those kind of MMO-style games, because, like you said, they were just kind of grindy. Mm-hmm. But I did kind of like the Final Fantasy MMO, because FF14 was
phenomenal. I really like that game.
They put in a bunch of quality of life stuff, I think, as a way of making up for the fact that it's subscription-based.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, most people are going for, like, the F2P model, or mostly F2P with, you know, like, purchases and stuff, because that's just kind of what people are willing to bite nowadays on MMOs. But, like, from what I've heard, FF14 is pretty good. Matt and Nat still play it a lot. I mean, it looks good, I guess.
I made it to Endgame in that, and it's a lot of fun. I mean, like, I played Monk, which I've almost always exclusively played tanking classes in MMOs, and Monk was the first, like, time I genuinely played a really good just melee DPS class, because all Monk is positioning yourself correctly, and I got to be this little Lalafell dude who, to do proper damage, you had to get behind the enemy, and when you're Lalafell, that puts you, like, directly in line with their taint. So, I named my character Taint Punch Magoo. Because I was just a little Lalafell punching,
What's up with that mummy? He's just kind of standing there.
Yeah, so these guys...
chilling.
Let me see if I can, there's a quick kill on these guys if you can get the two of them to stand, like, in each other. It, like, counts your blows as, like, multiple hits at the same time. I played FF14 for a bit with PA Master, and that was a lot of fun.
Yeah, and some of that group still plays it. I would probably still be playing it if it wasn't subscription-based, because, I mean, it's a fair subscription amount, but it's just, you know, I bought a car and then I had to cut back on stuff.
Yeah.
Well, and it's a time sink. And it's I am trying to avoid time sinks.
That's fair.
One thing they did, which was really cool, though, because I have... Oh, damn, I was hoping to hit...
Whoops.
I was hoping the bat to knock me into the, to knock me into the platform. So, I played the beta of FF14, which is, like, astronomically bad. Damn it.
Yeah.
The beta of FF14 was, like, legitimately terrible. They were people, and, like, it was so bad that they literally in-game nuked the world. That, they had Bahamut literally, like, destroy FF14, and they're like, fuck it, we're taking, like, the four good characters from this, we're going to redo it as a Realm Reborn. And if
it's like part of the lore that the last game was so bad that they just remade it.
And they're like, I'm just gonna take a continue here. They're like, anyone who stuck with us during, like, the initial beta gets a custom mount, gets, you know, all these cosmetic items. And in addition to that, fucking mermaid. In addition to that, anyone who stuck with us gets a permanent discount on game time. It's like for most normal people, it's 15 a month. For these guys, it's like permanently $11 a month.
That's not a bad deal.
Like,
no.
I have friends who are like, it was worth playing that shitty game just to be able to play the really good thing it ended up becoming.
The last thing I saw, like, the last update I took part in, there's, like, a developer room that you went into to, like, talk to the developers, and they were all kind of telling you, it's like, yeah, we made mistakes, and so we decided to remake the world or something like that.
Okay.
It is really cool when developers actively play their game. Mm-hmm. And interact with people.
With an MMO, you kind of have to, though.
Yeah.
Unless you just outsource it, in which case... I mean, I guess you could do that.
Well, I mean, like, it's big enough of a thing where they're having, like, an FF14 fan, like, community. Kind of like what I went through with Camp Fangamer. Mm-hmm. And I mean, like, Blizzard does BlizzCon, but Blizzard also has, like, 10 other IPs. so they can afford to have their own convention. They can afford to have their own
Yeah, they've got the money to spare. And as much as I like Overwatch, Blizzard still does some kind of skeevy shit.
I mean, they do skeevy shit with Overwatch.
Yeah, they do skeevy shit with Overwatch.
It happened with these Summer Olympic Games, and it's gonna happen again for their next holiday, I guarantee you.
Yeah. Oh, the next holiday will coincidentally... You mean the next holiday coincidentally when Titanfall 2 comes out.
That's gonna happen?
I think it's going to happen. Because that's like one of the only games that theoretically has any real competition for them.
That's fair. Oh, what about Battleborn? I heard they're up to a dozen players now.
Oh, poor. I feel so bad for Battleborn.
I feel sorry for them.
I don't. Because Gearbox is kind of shitty.
Yeah. I can't argue that.
Well, I mean, other than, like, the tenuous success they had with Borderlands, like, even still, a lot of that aesthetic and design sensibility was stolen from an independent animated film. And not even properly credited. They also, just had a lot of gall when it came to advertising and butting up against Overwatch in their advertising. It was a lot like Sega versus Nintendo, but absolutely pitiful.
So yeah, I'm not letting this guy go fucking anywhere.
No, he seems quite comfy.
Does what Blizz
and quite crispy now.
Yeah.
So what was that imp doing? Was he, like, giving the guy instructions?
It's Dracula and Igor. But I didn't let
Dracula
them...
Dracula and Igor?
If you have a three-shot multiplier and holy water, you can freeze any
enemy. What is this,
enemy.
Pitbull?
Yeah, pretty much.
How often do you find an entire turkey in a pinball machine?
But if you have that, you can literally stop any... like, almost any monster from doing anything. You can cheese Dracula and cheese, Death with it, but I actually really like
how do you get a three-shot multiplier? Is that the number three you've got there?
Yeah, that means I can throw three at the same time.
Oh, okay.
You don't have to forgive me, because, like, I've mostly played, like, Bloodlines and Up. Bloodlines, Symphony of the Night, and that remake of, oh, is it Rondo of Blood?
Yeah, that
so
was a
there's
good
like,
one.
It was. It really, really overlooked, too. But, is there like, a flinch chance in this game?
So what it does is, kind of like with, the coding in Zelda, where you, like, hit a certain amount of enemies and you can throw, you can get bombed from as a drop. When you get a sub-weapon in this game, you, there's this invisible counter, and every time you break something with it, it can be an enemy, it can be a block, it can be a candle. After you do 10 of them, I believe, the next item that you get is going to be a double or a triple multiplier. Normally, holy water is not that broken of a weapon, because you can only really throw one of them and have that really long flame, which means that if an enemy takes a step back, you know, you're kind of fucked. There's really no way to recover from it. You have to wait for it to flame out before you can toss again. Well, if you have multiple, if you had multiple ones of them, you can throw one, throw two, throw three, and if they stand in it, they're guaranteed to get stunned. So you can throw three of them when, like, kind of like what I did for that Frankenstein guy there, where he couldn't take a step forward.
Is there, like, a damage threshold you have to pass in order to stun people, or is it, like, a random thing that is just incredibly likely if you use three weapons?
No, it's only one of them is actually needed to do it, but if you throw three of them, just by the way Simon's throwing animation goes, by the time the first one ends, you can throw, another one. So basically...
Okay, so one will stun, but you stun lock them if you throw multiple.
Pretty much.
Okay.
Basically making it so that there's always a fire in front of them.
Right.
Yeah. It's like you can do the same thing to Death in this stage. You can do the same thing to Dracula if you want. But in order to get that, you have to make sure, like, otherwise getting a normal double shot multiplier is hard to get it to drop randomly.
Mm-hmm.
There's only like a couple of places in the entire game it will randomly happen.
Yeah, is there like the triple shot like a really rare item?
Yeah, but you can force it if you do what I mentioned before and basically use your sub weapon to break X amount of boxes and candles and whatnot.
Does it disappear when you die?
Yes. Which means that I'm actually not in the best place right now. Because I really want to have, if I wanted to cheese Death, which, again, I'm not really going for, I would just...
Uh-oh.
That's fine. I'm actually really I'm really
get back down there.
What I lose in this is I had a ton of hearts built up, and now I only have a certain amount of hearts. Not the end of the world. I'm pretty used to doing this fight like this. But
this isn't nearly as bad as playing like Gradius.
Yeah.
Oh, right, where if you die, you just get sent back into the same wave at like
and
pitiful.
And you lost all your power-ups too.
You got a pea shooter instead of five options shooting lasers.
Does Gradius have that system where you'll pick up like a roulette power-up and then you have to press the button to make it stop?
Sort of. There's basically only one power-up and it activates a thing on the bottom of the screen where it advances one place for every power-up you get. And at the lower end of the spectrum, you just get like speed up and stuff like that. But if you get towards the end, you get stuff like options and like upgrades to your main shot.
So
in between, you get the stuff like backfire or like bombs that shoot downward.
But like in Gradius, is there like an oh no thing where it resets your power ups, like in Barodius?
Sort of. There's one option on the very end of the roulette that does a random thing. You can actually set it in some games, like Gradius 3. Sometimes the thing they do or the things they do aren't that great, like resetting your speed, which can actually be devastating depending on the level. But generally, it's just like little stuff, not necessarily bad, like restoring your shield.
Uh-huh. So it's kind of like a chance.
Sort of. It's a chance if you don't know, like, which setup gives you which mystery thing, because it is set, depending on which loadout you get.
Whoa!
There are certain... Uh-oh.
Oh no, I tried to take my cartridge out!
Oh, you shouldn't do that, Tom.
What in the...
Blow on it!
Flying fuck. So, that happened.
Castlevania's ruined.
Oh no.
So welcome to Castlevania.
I've never seen that happen in this particular Nintendo system.
I have.
Oh yeah, the Nintendo Windows 10.
Right.
What?
From Galoob.
In the fuck was that? All right.
You might want to keep your finger on the F1 key for save states.
Yeah, I'd be saving after each boss now.
That's what I'm going to do. I played this ROM quite a number of times, and that shit's never happened.
Or we could just fuck off and play Kid Dracula.
That was right before my favorite moment in the game, and it only took us maybe... I can get back there. Not that long.
Yeah, we've only been streaming for what, like 20 minutes
like
or so?
25 minutes, yeah.
I'm more upset than anything. What the fuck?
I'd be mad for you.
It's incredibly weird. I've never seen an emulator freeze like that.
Yeah. I guess that's the power of Dracula's curse.
The funny part is, when we were getting the stream set up, Paloka was actually telling us about how we're trying to look up tips and tricks guides, to kind of make fun of and stuff. And we found a guide that was literally talking about, oh, you know, if you pull out your Nintendo cartridge, but only a little bit, You can get your... You can, like...
You can mess your score up.
Yeah, you can get a high score that way.
It wasn't a tip, it wasn't a trick, it wasn't a strategy. It was just, hey, if you almost take your cartridge out of the Nintendo when the power is on, your score will get messed up. If you do it correctly.
So I'm laughing at myself saying, oh man, I want to make a joke about how I can do that with the cartridge. Turns out the game fucking did it for me.
Yeah, I wanted to see if we could find, like, those... They usually call them, like, tips and tricks videos.
Yeah.
Where, like, the whole point is to help you get a better score.
How to get all those stars in Super Mario 64.
Or get that high score in Pac-Man.
How to defeat the Ninja Turtles game.
Get the most out of your quarter.
That's such a terrible game.
Get the most.
But apparently, none of the VHS tapes start at Castlevania 1. They all start at Castlevania 2.
Yeah, because that game is impossible to, like, figure out what the fuck you have to do in it.
Yeah.
I can only imagine how many 9-year-olds were just pulling their hair out.
I didn't even know what the Terrible Night to Have a Curse text did.
Doesn't it just make everything darker?
It makes everything darker and specifically harder, yeah.
Like, enemies become
tougher.
Does
it just add more enemies?
Yeah, enemies are just tougher. I don't remember if it actually increased their quantity?
It made them take more hits before they die.
Yeah.
So, I actually kind of like that mechanic. Because it's kind of...
It's cool.
It's kind of what they did in, like, Silent Hill 2. The idea of,
Yeah, when Silent Hill 2 just paused for a second and said it's a terrible night to have a curse.
Basically.
The whole concept of the other world.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, those games were kind of like the first ones to have, like, a day-night, you know, light world, dark world system.
I remember the light and dark worlds, but did that actually modify the stats of enemies you fought?
No, it just made... It just, in terms of environment. It made
okay,
it...
It probably
so,
just
yeah,
made
just
them spookier.
Yeah.
Yeah,
because I remember playing a lot of Silent Hill 2 and just being generally equally frustrated with the combat system from start to finish.
Well, Silent Hill 2, you didn't need to ever use the combat system. That's kind of one thing I really liked about that game, the fact that you got the same ending playing it on easy as you did playing it on hardest. Like, no ending was locked out. You only had to beat the game one time, and after you beat the game one time, it'll, you have to beat it a second time to get, like, a few of the alternate endings. And that's really it. And every time you beat the game and start a new game plus, it, every time you got a new game plus, it'll, up the difficulty by 1 degree.
I didn't know that.
Yep.
Does it give you any of the perks? I don't remember.
Chainsaw.
I think it unlocks some special weapons.
Special weapons.
There's a chainsaw. There's like an enemy spray.
You can get the alien
like
ending.
Spray.
You mean the real ending?
Yeah, the good.
Yeah. The actual ending. The actual canon ending.
Let me,
There we go.
Yes.
I don't like
good
having
boy.
To do it, but not shit again.
No, just save it to your memory card. It's fine.
The old NES memory card.
Right. It's got an LCD of Pikachu on it.
Let me pop out my VMU.
Era, yeah, the era where they have the little pocket memory cards that have the LCDs on them that fucking no games used.
The little pocket station that nobody ever used.
Yeah. It's like, oh, I've got a chocobo on.
Close.
One of my favorite things about that, though, was the failure of the pocket station led to, there was a series of Flash videos back in the day, called Sega Fantasy, where basically just people recreated the endings of FF5 and FF6, but as consoles instead of, characters. And the final boss of it was the PSP. So,
the PSP was Kefka?
Yeah. So, when you beat it, it kind of shows you, scenes of the world, you know, before, like, pretty much all the cutscenes you see at the end of FF6. And, one of them is Kefka getting, like, you know, gaining all the powers of the world. And in that, he's the pocket station.
That's so perfect, though.
It really is. Hate having to redo these two stages. These are always, like... 3 and
perilous.
4 are always the toughest parts of the game for me. And that was, like, one of the first times I managed to beat stage 3 without, like, dying or wasting a ton of time. So, like... That was a real goddammit moment for me.
It's okay, we'll just pretend like that was what happened here, and, time is frozen until we get back to where you were.
Oh no, I just...
Right, we're just training in the hyperbolic time chamber.
I just passed on the time upgrade, though. Can I despawn you? Nope, I can't.
Maybe you could try talking to them.
Meh! I mean, they got two heads. I'm sure one of them will listen to me.
One tells the truth and one always lies. Yeah.
Yeah.
Dave knows what's up.
On point.
One of us wipes our butt too much, and the other one not enough.
I mean, the reason why this stage is such a pain in the ass is if you can get it in one, like, fell swoop, you're pretty fine. But if you, like, mess one thing up, it's really hard to recover it.
Yeah.
I wonder what Game Genie codes there were for this.
The Naked Simon Belmont, I remember that.
Really?
Well, that's more like the ROM hack. Which I do not... Alright, is this guy just gonna... Alright, I'm just gonna let him dance for a little bit.
There's a GameGenie.com.
Oh, no.
Just let him dance. Boogie on down there.
Wow. There's an entire site dedicated to Game Genie codes.
Still?
Yeah, it's GameGenie.com. It's actual GameGenie.com.
Oh yeah, I think they still do support Game Genie codes and stuff, like...
How? Really?
I don't know if the 3DS has one, but the DS did.
Well, we've got categories here. We've got DS, GBA, PC, PS2, PS3, PSP, Wii, Xbox 360.
There we go.
And they've got a classic section, too.
So we got.
I have a feeling this is for codes in general, but there are some Game Genie codes.
Probably. I mean, it's got to take very little upkeep to have that site just full of text code.
Yeah. I mean, I had a Game Genie, and they had, like, they'd send you a little pamphlet with new codes every now and then.
I used to rent a Game Genie, and those always came with, like, the booklet full of stuff. I remember the only one the only one I clearly remember using it on was Little Nemo the Dream Master.
That was a fun game.
That one
did you guys ever see the animated film?
I loved it.
It's great, but it's so bizarre to watch because it was the animation was sourced. I don't remember which studio in Japan took it.
It was one made by people who were in, like, Ghibli had almost involvement with it.
Right. The thing is, it kept the American style completely, but so many of the sensibilities of the animation were very clearly anime. It's incredibly strange to watch in motion, because it does not play out at all like a Western animated feature.
Yeah,
camera angles to the animation techniques and, like, the backgrounds and stuff, it is a sight to see.
I'll have to check that out then.
It came out more like a Ghibli, like really close to a Ghibli.
It did. But it looked almost like a Bluth or Disney film.
Who produced it?
That's what I'm trying to remember. Let me look it up really quick. Little Nemo.
Because that's an old one.
I mean, like, the comic it was based on was from 1904.
Slumberland. Let's see.
Little Nemo in Dreamland or Slumberland or something.
It was Slumberland. Let me see. Production company, Tokyo Movie Shinja.
Oh my gosh.
TMS.
Yeah. They're the ones that are responsible for the really good-looking Animaniacs episodes.
Oh. Really?
And they actually they did one of the Sonic the Hedgehog episodes, too.
I had no idea.
I think they might have actually done a couple of those.
The only thing I can like remember off the top of my head that they've done otherwise is like the Loop in the Third series, which is amazing.
Well, they did a lot of Tiny Toons, too.
Oh, yeah, they've done a ton of Western stuff. Adventures of Sonic the Hedgehog, Batman the Animated Series, Batman Beyond,
yep.
Chippendale, Gargoyles. Wow, they've done tons of stuff.
They've done a lot. They're a good studio.
Yeah, they are. Legit.
Alright, so now I don't even feel bad about taking the cheap way out.
It looks like you'd be putting him out of his suffering. It looks like that little imp guy's just bumping his head.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The brand buckler. Come to think of it, I had a Game Genie when I was a kid, and it was for Genesis. The thing is, I didn't have the internet back when, and we didn't have any code books or anything, so I had no idea what Game Genie actually did, other than like provide cheats and stuff that I could not access.
Mm-hmm.
The thing is, I used it for a really long time as well, because it was one of those things where you pop it in, and just like Sonic and Knuckles, you pop the other game on top of it, and it takes it to the menu.
It was just like a tumor that was on Genesis.
Basically, yeah, I mean, what you would do is you would open it up, and the screen would play, and then you got your chance to enter a code. And the thing is, I would just put in gibberish and hope that my game got changed, because it didn't actually tell you if there was an error in the code you made. It would just start the game. And I was genuinely convinced that at some point I would punch it in and get something incredible. But that
did
never
it ever just did it ever just screw something up?
Astonishingly, no. I mean, it might have like frozen at start at some point for a game or two, but like, I never got any glitch fest or like even like fucked up textures or anything. It never really did much. And
Sonic
using it.
Sonic never looked at you and had blood coming out of his eyes and gave you one thumb up and said, "I'm coming for you. I'm coming for you, Max, whatever your last name is, tonight." At your house, and...
The Yellow Devil never popped on TV.
No. It was never on the Genesis. Now, the N-Gage, on the other hand...
Oh, no one played. Every N-Gage could have been haunted, and we never would know, because no one ever bought a fucking N-Gage.
We're not even sure if the N-Gage really existed.
It could have
just
been...
like a mass hypnosis fever dream.
The N-Gage
was
just
a terrible idea.
It was just Nokia's way of fucking. Yeah, a game console, putting games on your phone. What a crazy, messed up idea that would never, ever, ever catch on.
Well, I think a lot of the reason why the N-Gage died was, weird shit about the build quality aside, and the fact that you had to take the battery out to change games in the older models.
Yeah.
The support for it was absolutely abominable.
I didn't even know there was support for it.
Yeah, I mean, like, there were a lot of people who just kind of dumped third-party stuff on there, and you got really lousy ports of AAA games at the time. Like, I know Tony Hawk was on there, either Call of Duty or Medal of Honor had a game on there, and it was the funniest thing ever. I mean, considering when it came out, it wasn't actually that weak, hardware-wise.
Yeah.
I mean, it could do 3D rendering to some extent.
The one port I remember more than anything is Gamescom, which had a Resident Evil 2 port.
Oh man, did you ever see the Game Boy Color version of it?
Oh god, yeah.
No.
It was pretty bad.
It was beautiful.
I don't know what the fuck the Gamescom was even trying to do. It had, like, you could play games on it, but then it had, like, a digital assistant, like a calculator and a calendar and, like, an Ethernet port.
It wasn't trying to compete with the game console. It was trying to compete with PDAs.
It was more of a PDA than anything else. I don't know how extensively was the gaming support on that thing.
Not good.
And I think that was just because the capabilities were really low. It was still like black and white dot matrix.
Yeah, it was a really low-tech handheld.
Alright, so this is gonna
It was Tiger, what do you expect?
This is gonna be interesting.
Oh my god, yeah, it was Tiger.
This room right here is the room constantly known as the Hell Room. That was almost really, really bad.
Is it because of the RNG Medusa heads?
It's the RNG Medusa heads, it's having to track down, the Axe Knight to land hits on him, and also keeping enough health to let you fight death. I got in a really good situation here, in that I have a ton of hearts, and the cross and the three-shot multiplier, however I do not have a lot of health, so this is going to be a really tough death fight.
Look at all that animation on death.
Oh, I close. I killed him. I actually killed him.
Blow.
Oh, and now it gives me a double shot multiplier. Thank you.
You won. Look at your tiny little whip.
I have absolutely no shot. So, because I killed so many of his sights right there, instead of giving me the normal whip upgrade, it actually gave me the double shot, but I have no sub-weapon equipped, so it kinda doesn't help. So, this room setup... Christ. This room setup...
What does that potion do?
Invincibility.
Nah.
I'm not gonna risk it. So, that room up there is often called the hardest part of this entire game, with good reason, just because, you know, Medusa heads and axe guys, and it's such a long hallway to death, and unless you have both a good amount of hearts and a multiplier, death is really fucking hard. So, but there is kind of a way to make this not that hard.
Yeah, we could just give up and die.
The unfortunate part is, it is almost entirely luck-based. So, if you have a bad
opening... Is this a game that gives a lot of speedrunners trouble in general?
Yeah. You either have a good run or you don't.
Mm.
Even the best runners of this take damage and die. Mostly because there's a lot that's completely out of your control, and taking even one extra hit is the repercussions of taking one hit is really bad. So right now, hidden in this wall here is a power up, is a wall chicken. So what I actually want to do, and this is the most important part, is I want to get into the middle. I want to start scrolling the screen. If you're in a part where the screen's begun to scroll, then even if the Medusa heads come at you, they will never ever hit you. So you want to kill the first guy using, you want to kill that first guy using just, boomerangs, so you can get that shot multiplier up. Now, I have a lot of time. I want to... I can't even explain it without taking damage. That first one up there, that's the one that I was looking for. This first one's always a big heart. And I want to get as many hearts as possible. Like, so right now, I have 2 shot multipliers, and I have about 30 hearts. A really good place to be. So again, I want to scroll the screen and just start throwing boomerangs at him. If one of these Medusa heads doesn't drop the 3-shot multiplier, the next candle I whip will. Right there.
Alright.
Nice manipulation.
Back in business.
unfortunately, I still need a fair amount of hearts to take down Death.
Death, yeah.
And yeah, it's not gonna happen. Pretty much to get that set up, it means that you can't get hit more than twice by,
I'm noticing that the enemies take, like, a fuck ton of life off you, too.
Yeah, the damage that you take from enemies is not dependent by the enemy itself, but by what stage you're on. So when you're in stage 5 and 6, any enemy will do, 4 health.
That's cruel.
Even the little dudes.
That means that you die in 3 hits. That's really not good. The wall chicken can restore half your health, which means if you take more than 2 hits, you're not going into death with full health. If you're going in, the speedrunning strat is to go in and just fight him with the holy water, which will take him out in no time. And like, he won't even get his sights in if you spam him with holy water. But I don't like that. There are a couple of fights I don't mind cheesing in this game, but the death fight is actually my favorite in the entire Castlevania series. And it's like it's like a personal vow, I'm never cheesing that fight.
It kind of reminds me of my vendetta against Quick Command in Mega Man 2.
Yeah, who was hard in Mega Man 2, impossible in Mega Man 3.
He was just miserable in 2. And yet,
this stage was a big pain in the butt, too.
Yeah, it could be huge. I mean, like, if you don't remember the laser pattern, it will kill you.
I think the biggest kick in the dick to Flashman stage is that you need, the biggest kick in the dick to Quickman stage is that you need the Flashman weapon, in order to get past his, the lasers. Like, it's not
a... You didn't need them. You just needed to remember everything.
No, for some of the later ones, you need it.
No, you don't. I learned that the hard way.
It's nearly impossible otherwise. But...
Yeah, I know.
So then, what a kick in the dick it is where... And it's the only sub-weapon that you cannot just use it in, like, one short burst and then, you know, rely on
something
else.
Yeah,
you have to use all of it.
Yeah, all of it in one go. So it's like, alright, so now this thing that you're guaranteed to be completely out of, guess what? That boss is weak to it. then we could either be the free shot or, wall chicken, and I was really hoping for it to be wall chicken.
Maybe next time. See, I actually did it the opposite way. I used the time stop to get through the stage because I was young and stupid, and then I fought Quickman and realized that he's semi-random and incredibly hard to beat in general. Which, you know, when you're like, I don't know, 10, 12, it's a miserable experience. So I figured out and I memorized all of the lasers going down his stage. It's possible to get through it. It is harrowing, and I think I lost 7 or 8 years on the asset of my life for it, but I figured it out. Just so I could use it on Quickman and take off a little over half of his health.
Against Quickman,
before he started doing horrible shit.
Against Quickman, I always just use the crash bombs.
They are effective enough, yeah.
Mostly because he always runs to the corner. Like, I took advantage of the fact that Quickman always runs to the corner.
Yeah, he can. You can manipulate him into the corner pretty easily, but I mean,
I want to mention that Max's Skype icon is like a goofy picture of Mega Man in 3D holding up a Glock.
Yeah.
Oh god.
He's having a grand old time.
Oh no.
It kind of does make me miss, though, the older Mega Man games having boss weaknesses that were more than just, like, I think they adopted it for, like, 3 and onwards, where, like, every weapon and your regular Buster shot will do 1 damage to almost every boss except for, like, the one who's weak to Buster, and then, like, their weakness will do, like, 3 ticks instead of 1, and that's all you got.
Yeah.
Whereas in Mega Man 1 and 2, variable weaknesses did varying amounts of damage. And that was actually pretty cool. Because it did offer you some variation in and fallbacks to like what you could use against certain bosses. Like, I never actually tried it myself, but does Metal Man really die to one single Metal Blade?
Two.
Really?
Alright, so annoying thing about Death, even if you beat Death, his sickles still remain on the screen.
Will they still move and possibly take you out?
Yes. And you have to wait about...
I think that's what might have been what happened last time.
Yeah, that's what
died, and there was a boomerang going through the air, and it hit Death after he had died.
Yeah. Oh, so it was opposite.
Yeah.
Alright, so Death is the real hurdle of the game. In my opinion. Oh,
Yeah, Metal Blade was busted in two.
I should probably, do that.
Save it to your memory card.
Save it to the NES hard drive.
Woo!
It's a good thing you did.
Simon Belmont dropped his grapes and decided to take a nap.
Alright. So this is always... I always have a little bit of trouble with this. Mostly because you have to, like, time out your jumps really weird. In order to make sure they don't hit you.
These bats, do they have like the same health as the little mini boss in the first stage?
Yeah, it's the entire first stage boss. This part's kinda shitty. Not as bad as the others, but if you don't take any damage on the bat part, it's not that bad.
This isn't the one that has the invisible blocks, is it?
No. They really didn't do any of that shit until, 3. Like, the platform in this game
They're not invisible, they're fall-through blocks.
Yeah. Most platforming in this game is actually relatively straightforward.
Changing elevation is your biggest enemy in this game, not really the complexity of the platforming.
Yeah, you can't jump on the stairs, can you?
No. Actually...
It's a big pain in the butt, and the trajectory of your weapons are so limited.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you basically only have, like, the axe as far as attacking things above you goes.
That's why sub-weapons in this game are super important.
Yeah. There's a reason why I never finished this game.
So, I haven't fought Drac in a long time, so this is going to be interesting. Drac will kill you in 4 hits. Easy.
His sprite makes him look like Waldorf.
Yeah, his sprite's not exactly the most imposing.
Ooh. He's got, like, kind of a Squidward nose.
I always kind of saw it more as, like, a Jason Voorhees type thing, where he had a mask over his face.
It does look conspicuously like a mask, especially because that's the first thing that materializes.
Yeah.
Are you guaranteed to get whip power-ups in there?
Yes. And if you... It's the most annoying thing in the world, but if you have time, you can go down the stairs there, come up, and get a couple more hearts. Keep grinding out those hearts. The biggest way,
the
easiest way
triple?
To... you can get the triple, you can get triple shot, you can get, what's it? You can get infinite hearts, if you want. You have, like... 500 seconds to actually kill Dracula.
Oh, yeah, the timer.
So you can go up and down these stairs something like 20 times to just grind the fuck out of hearts.
Unless we put in the Game Genie code SXXXYAAX for infinite time.
I'm sorry, was that a 0 or an O?
Because there are some people who will basically fire the boomerang to knock out all those fireballs.
That's actually a pretty sick strat.
That's a good, That's a good.
It's a good.
You're a good at this game.
Wow,
thank
man.
Thank you so much for the play.
Boomerang is really forgiving with its hitbox.
Yeah, the hitbox of his is actually fucking gigantic.
I mean, that thing's already passing through his colon before the fireballs come out, and they're still fizzling.
An interesting thing, his fireballs actually have a shot at dropping more hearts or a multiplier.
That's not too surprising. I don't know if it's intentional or not, but it seems like kind of a trope with final bosses giving you periodic power-ups.
Yeah, because otherwise this fight is not forgiving, in the slightest.
You picked something up.
Oh, I got a an extra life. Because every time you hit that, you are rocketing up points. I actually want to stop. I need to save a little bit of hearts for its second phase.
Oh, he has a phase two?
Yep.
He only has a phase two in this one, because in most Castlevania games he's got like five.
Yeah. But I mean, this is a... You played Symphony of the Night. The beginning of the game is an homage to this.
Yeah. Oh!
Oh, no!
Does he sometimes just shoot fireballs up?
The thing is, they track you.
Yeah, they track your movement.
Oh, so you have to actually jump after they
Yeah, after he fires them.
Yeah. So, I have the timing relatively down, but it's still gonna... The hardest part about the fight with Dracula is his teleportation. Because sometimes he will be a step or two away from you. Sometimes he will be... And most times, he'll teleport to where you just were. Not always, though. And sometimes he will be directly on you, which if his back... Basically, if he's teleporting to where you're facing and your back is facing him, or his back is facing you, you don't have time to get out of his hitbox. You're guaranteed to take a hit. And I think it's every... five times, he's guaranteed to show up where you are, or on the opposite side of the room. Once you get,
I don't actually remember what his fourth or his second form does in this game. Like, what his attack patterns are. Is it more difficult, or is it just as much of a pain in the ass?
It's more difficult because his hitbox, like he becomes a giant. Like almost dragon thing, and his hitbox
he turns
is still,
into a monster.
Yeah, his hitbox is still only his head, but he it looks like his hitbox should be like gigantic
everywhere.
If you throw fire, fireballs, holy water. Ooh, yeah, see, like that, he teleported directly into his hitbox. Like that. God damn it.
That's entirely luck-based.
Yeah. The good thing is, if you're standing still and facing him... this is what fucked me up the last time we played this game on our last charity stream. I had the game beat in about 15-20 minutes, but the Dracula fight took me like 30. So, like, if he gets you on two or three of those teleportation ones, it's like you absolutely cannot fuck up anything else with this fight.
Yeah, that was really unfair.
Well, the nice thing is, if you game over, it doesn't send you back to, like, the bat bridge. You still get to be right here.
Oh, that's good.
Well...
Does this game have unlimited continues?
Yes. It has
to. Okay.
It has to.
Nobody would beat it otherwise.
What I'm going to do is once
Well, that didn't stop Ninja Gaiden.
Yeah. No, Ninja Gaiden had the worst because Ninja Gaiden had on the final boss, if you made it to the final boss and died, you had to redo everything. Like,
I'm gonna call it right now, Ninja Gaiden fucking sucked. It wasn't fun and it wasn't good.
I liked everything except for the last part of it.
Ugh.
No, it's but just, see, if you don't play games that aren't... If you, you know, that's how you prove you're a hardcore gamer.
It's like, to me, like, Ninja Gaiden and Battletoads are like the poster children of Nintendo Hard, which is kind of an oxymoron, because all of the hard games were developed by third-party companies.
And on Sega Genesis.
But they were... I can't really think of all that many games that were on Genesis that were stupendously hard. At least, like, games that are considered good that are hard, because hard is very arbitrary. But, like, I played the shit out of Battletoads and Ninja Gaiden when I was younger, and I bought into that whole hardcore old game machismo bullshit. But, like, looking back and playing them now, they're just badly designed games. They're overly hostile, and a lot of the difficulty comes from stuff that isn't, like, deliberate design. It's just, like, really brutal character respawns and bad choices.
Like, you've got a health meter in Battletoads, mm-hmm. which, past, like, the first two stages is fucking pointless, because everything
kills you. Yeah, it's entirely irrelevant. And the weird thing is, it's just, like, it's a really disappointing game, too, because, like, you play the first stage of Battletoads, it's like, cool, this is a side-scrolling beat-em-up, it's kind of neat, it's a little basic, but it's fun. It's not particularly challenging, but it's goofy, cartoony, and, like, you get that in the Turbo Tunnel as well. And then, like, after that, it just becomes Twitch platformer, where instant death looms around every...
Or fucking Rat Race.
The Rat Race is impossible without, like, save states. I swear to God, I have Battletoads on Genesis, and I can play it, and I can usually get to the intruder excluder without much of a problem because I'm horrible, but the like handful of times I've ever had the patience to get through it and make it to Rat Race, I've never been able to beat it on the lives I had.
Yeah.
Like, you had no margin for error.
No, zero. There just didn't even seem to be any rhyme or reason to how quickly he made it down compared to you.
I mean, you literally just had to run the course perfectly.
Yep. Well, the thing is, knowing where the warps are, like, a couple of them are really handy, but you can't skip out on the second stage, which is the Wookiee hole, where you could potentially farm, like, 50 lives off of bouncing crows off the wall. Because God knows you're not going to be able to survive the game without, like, 20 lives.
Whoa.
So, yeah.
I don't remember Cookie Monster Dracula.
Yeah. That's why he's a real pain in the ass. He can shoot you. If you're standing far away from him, he'll jump. But you can't really get in good attacks on him. Let me try and take this guy out real quick.
Yeah, Wrench in chat mentioned a hard game for Sega. I don't know if you count this or not, but like the Sega Master System, which was before the Sega Genesis.
Oh, Sonic 2!
Yeah, had the old Master System Sonic games, which those were hard. And
really?
I remember those because I had Game Gear ports.
I was going to say, Game Gear, if it's anything like the Game Gear Sonic 2, I totally agree.
That's
exactly what it is.
Yeah.
I believe, I could be wrong, but I believe that the Game Gear Sonic games were ports of the Master System
Zoomed
Sega
in ports.
Games.
Zoomed in
yeah,
ports,
that makes a lot of sense. Sonic 2 on the Game Gear, as I remember it, was absolutely brutal because you never got any health for the bosses. Like, there were just no rings present on those stages. And the first one is such a ball buster. You have to fight this, like, antlion thing on an incline while Eggman drops balls of varying like bounciness down. And you just have to survive.
You have to like avoid them, and when like the balls are supposed to go down and hit the antlion.
Yeah.
But they have like these, they're set angles, but some of the angles, they're like really hard to dodge.
Yeah, because like if you jumped, because of the way the physics worked, you would just end up like jumping right towards the antlion, and you couldn't alter your momentum very easily.
Yeah. Which, the fact that they had no rings in those stages, that's a hard boss.
He jumps short, or he'll jump high, like really high.
Yeah, this is one of those.
Can you just like stay away from him and like chuck boomerangs?
Not really, because not really, because his hitbox is up in the sky.
The Game Gear version of Sonic 2 was harder because there was no set pattern to the balls, unlike Sega Master System.
That's weird, because I could almost swear I remember there was a pattern to the balls. There was one that bounced low and one that bounced high, and they just alternated.
The last one was like a high bounce.
I mean, either way, even if you knew it was coming, it was hard as fuck.
Yeah.
For level
and then
one.
They also had the emeralds or something. Like there were secret gems that you had to find, but they were just hidden in the stages.
Man, I don't remember that much.
I remember that in the Sonic Game Gear Sonic 1 was, they were just hidden in the stage. Some of them were really impossible to find.
Oh, that explains it. The in the Master System version, the ball just had one height.
Okay.
Well, Sonic 1 on Master System was harder because the screen wasn't as zoomed in so much. Like, for the Game Gear one, they had to obviously reduce the size of the screen. So, like, the very first Robotnik fight in it, he does, like, two laps around the screen and will fire a barrage of bullets and then drop down. But if you're playing it on Master System, you can hit him.
Before Oh, Jesus.
So behold the power of Dual Shot.
Hey, cut it out.
You still need a lot. You still need
smile and shit the pain.
Ah! I thought I was gonna jump! Cause his tell for jump is the exact same as his tell for shoot bullets.
Does he jump multiple times before firing? I haven't been paying close attention to that.
The pattern isn't really like the pattern's kinda hard to discern.
Damn, Dracula, you're an asshole.
That's what I mean. The drag fight is almost pure luck.
Oh, damn.
Yeah,
Oh, damn!
Oh, damn.
That was actually really...
a long way to climb, but...
Yeah, that was actually really lucky.
Can you stunlock him with that?
Not in the first form, but I can in the second form.
I mean, second form?
Yeah, it will take almost every heart that I have, though. So, I have to be in his first form without taking any more damage.
Yeah.
Like, if you want to get the multiplier up on this part of track, you pretty much have to get hit by at least one of his fireballs. Because, I'll explain after the fight.
Yeah, just concentrate for now.
I want to see you do this. Is it just me, or are some of those hits just not registering?
No, it's because he's,
he just has a lot of health.
No, you have a very short window to hit him in.
Oh, is that so?
Yeah.
I thought it just took multiple lashes to take him down one notch.
Nope. Basically, to get a good shot landed on him, I have to jump in such a way that his bullets can hit me, can track me.
I see.
So I don't want to go crazy tossing here, because otherwise I will entirely run out of potions. And if I throw multiple ones at the same time, it's not like they stack damage.
Right.
It's all a matter of time. So right now I have 15, and if I were to just toss them willy-nilly, I would have ran out of potions by now, and the fight would have been impossible. Even now, I still have to deliver the final blow with the whip.
Oh boy.
You did it, dude.
I still have to deliver the final blow with the whip.
Woo!
Yeah.
What a fight.
Jeez. Come to think of it, I did have Sonic 2 for the Game Gear, and like other than the first boss though, I don't remember it being as hardcore. Like that was just he was one hell of a gatekeeper. I don't know if I actually beat the game, but
so now we get my favorite part of this, the credits with Bran Stoker and James Banana. Christopher B.
Christopher B.
Rest
my favorite actor.
Bela Lugosi. Love Chaney Jr. Let's see, I think I have Rondo of Blood actually on my Wii U. So, because it didn't take us all that long to do this.
Simon Del Nondo?
Belmondo.
The end looked like an N. So, a lot of people talk about, actually, you know what? What was I saying before we finished that fight where I said I would explain once the fight was over? Oh, when you got
the way his hitbox works, right?
And why getting a multiplier on the holy water is a pain in the ass. When you throw the holy water, the flame hitting something doesn't count as upping the multiplier. Only the act of the holy water coming into contact with something while it's being thrown does. So you have to wait for him to fire the fireballs, then throw the holy water, wait for them to connect, which you don't have time to jump afterwards. You always, unless you get a perfect toss, you're always going to get nicked by one or two of the fireballs. So I kind of had to take those couple of hits early on. And, I got really lucky that those multipliers dropped real quick. Because he fires three fireballs, it's like one or two good ones will guarantee you a multiplier. So give me a real quick second while I see if I have, if I have it on the Wii U and if it's all set up. Guess I'll just let some good vampire hunter play while I do that. All right, give me
nice
one second.
Intermission.
Yep, give me one second. I'll be right back.
Take your time. Now, Dave, other than Symphony of the Night, did you play any of the other, like, more recent Castlevania games? People remember, like, the heavy RPG elements and stuff like that?
Probably the most recent ones that I played were the ones that had Soma.
Mm.
So, I think maybe Portrait of Ruin. I think that might have been it.
Portrait of Ruin.
Portrait of Ruin, Harmony of Dissonance. And then
we're
there
talking
was,
like the DS games, right?
Yeah, the DS games. And there was a really strange one that was on the Xbox console, which was like a multiplayer game where you could play.
Oh, I think I know what you're talking about.
You could play with the different heroes from the different Castlevania games.
Yeah.
And you got four players, and you would run through a stage where you had to, I think, complete certain objectives to beat the stage.
What the hell was that? It's gonna kill me now. Let's find it.
Yeah. So you could have, like, Alucard, Simon Belmont, and they all played, like, their original, like, style. And I think you could get, like, items and equips and stuff.
Oh, I wonder... No, that's... Was it 360 or original Xbox? Because I'm thinking of an Xbox game. I want to say that was 360. Game. Okay, then we might not be on the same page anymore.
Xbox multiplayer. Harmony of Despair.
Harmony of Despair.
Yeah. Castlevania Harmony of Despair, known in Japan as blah 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 blah, is a crossover platform adventure game that features a new map system which allows players to see the current quest's map entire setup, as well as up to six players at once over Xbox Live. The game was first leaked as an rating. Xbox Live Summer of Gaming 2010. Was released worldwide on August 4th, 2010 for the Xbox Live Arcade and September 27th, 2011 for the PlayStation Network.
Okay. Yeah, that wasn't the one I was thinking of, but I might have just been mixing them together because that's so early. Also, I'll be right back. I gotta go see a man about a horse.
Okay.
All right, I'm back.
And now we're waiting on Max.
Yep.
We were just talking about the Castlevania multiplayer game that was on Xbox and PlayStation.
Oh, yeah. The
Castlevania Harmony of Despair.
Harmony of Dissonance, I think.
No, it was Harmony of Despair. Harmony of Dissonance was
the Game Boy one
of the Game Boy games.
Yeah.
Yeah. Was met with mixed reception, scoring 7.5 GameSpot,
like
praises the praises the multiplayer where it's the best way to experience the thrill of discovery is gone, and in its place is the compulsive drive to acquire loot.
That's the that's the worst part.
And only six stages.
I did like that it let you play as Julius, though.
Yeah, extra playable characters such as Yoko Belnades, Julius Belmont, Maria Renard, and Richter Belmont. An 8-bit Simon Belmont was released on January 2011.
Wow, I didn't know they'd bother with DLC for that game. I mean, I guess money, money, money. One thing I completely forgot is how big of a pain in the ass it is to get Wii points on your on the Wii. I didn't have it downloaded.
I don't know, I haven't.
Yeah, I didn't have it downloaded, but I'm getting it on now, and man, they need like your address and everything. Like that's the reason why I haven't
Go ahead.
There's a reason why I didn't put screen share up yet.
All right. What, you don't trust me?
It's more for the people who I'm going to be uploading it to YouTube for.
All right. Let's see. It had Alucard, Soma Cruz, Jonathan Morris, Shanoa, Charlotte Owlin. Portrait of Ruin?
Yeah. Sequel to Bloodlines.
I kind of liked it.
I thought it was fun.
I mean, it wasn't nothing special, but I had fun with it.
I liked the Richter fight in it. See if that authorization goes through. Yeah, it did. Alright, let me activate.
I heard Nintendo was like